being here with us this morning to worship our Lord and Savior, whether you're here in person, online, or through our radio ministries. Thank you. We're glad to be worshiping with you. Don't have an awful lot of announcements this morning. Our children will be taking their July journey later this month, so I know that will be a lot of fun. Next Sunday, we will be commissioning our youth. We'll be going on their mission trip. They'll be commissioning services in both services next week, so be sure to be here for that. And that's what we have so far today. Now our choir will lead us in our call to worship. Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Now our lead us, we join as we sing our hymn of praise, number 698 in your hymnal, God of the Ages. Now, you will join me in our historic confession of the Christian faith on page 881 of your hymnal. I believe in God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Saints of his, praise his holy name, for his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may remain for a night, but rejoicing comes in the morning. When I felt secure, I said, I will never be shaken. O Lord, when you favored me, you made my mountain stand firm, but when you hid your face, I was dismayed. To you, O Lord, I called. To the Lord, I cried for mercy. What gain is there in my destruction, in my going down to the pit? Will the dust praise you? Will it proclaim your faithfulness? Hear, O Lord, and be merciful to me. O Lord, be my helper. You turn my wailing into dancing. You remove my sackcloth and clothe me with joy, that my heart may sing to you and not be silent. O Lord, my God, I will give you thanks forever. Next, sing our hymn of preparation, number 696 in your hymnal. And stay seated in America, sing America the Beautiful.
Thank you. This time, as we prepare to go before the Lord in prayer, are there those that you would like to offer up in prayer this morning? Yes.
Our military, our veterans, our first responders and their families. The soldiers that are in Ukraine. And their soldiers again.
Yes. Anyone else? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, bring your blessings upon this church and upon this congregation, as you always do. And bring your blessings upon our nation as we remember again the sacrifices made by all who fought to ensure our independence and our liberty and our freedom. Lord, on this day, we especially lift up those who have been named this morning and those who have not been, those who you know to be suffering, those who you know are in need of your strength, who are in need of your forgiveness, who are in need of your comfort. We would ask that you be with each person who is in need of you. Lord, we ask especially again your blessings on our country. We find ourselves not just in our country, but all over the world, driven by strife and by wars and by controversy. And Lord, we would ask that you heal the divisions, that you heal our nations, that you bring us together. May we always be reminded that our first loyalty always is to you, because it is from you that all of our blessings and our liberty, our freedoms, all that we have comes from you. And Lord, teach us to pray as you taught your disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Right.
Our scripture lesson this morning comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 16. I'll be reading verses 13 through 20. When Jesus came into the coasts of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And they said, "Some say that you are John the Baptist, others Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He said unto them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered and said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Blessed are you, Simon Barone, for flesh and blood has not revealed it to you, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loose in heaven." Then he charged his disciples that they should tell no one that he was Jesus the Christ. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So a question for you this morning. How many of you have ever built something? How many of you have ever built a house? Or been involved with the building of a house? Or overseen the building? There you go. I knew some of you had. That's always been one of the most fascinating things for me ever since I was a child, was watching houses and buildings be built. The first one I can remember is when my parents built their house on Woodland Way. That year was 1972, 50 years ago, that house started construction. It was finished the following year, but I remember that was one of the things we did every day after school or after my father got home from work, is that we would go over and we would see what had been done with the new house that day. And a construction site is a cool place for a kid. There are all kinds of things to do. There are sand piles. There are blocks of wood. You can walk through the walls. That was fun. We just couldn't get over that. Just walk from one room to the other through the studs in the walls before the sheetrock was installed. I loved watching that house go up. And then when it was done, there was nothing better. And I still to this day don't think there's anything better than the smell of a brand new house. All the wood and the paint and the varnish and all of the glue and the carpet and everything that goes into it, it just is a wonderful aroma. And it will never, ever smell that good again. I remember as I got older, in my teenage years, I would go with Herman Waits when he was building his house. And when I was a little older still, I would go with Wayne down to Fox Hollow Wood Drive to see his new house under construction. And I learned a lot from these two, if you can believe that I learned anything from Herman. But believe it or not, Herman knew more than you would think about the quality of materials and things like that. And Wayne can build anything. Wayne could build a car out of a junk pile of parts. So it was no surprise that he would be heavily involved in the building of his house. I've always enjoyed watching these kind of things go up. As a kid, I built a lot of things in my own way, with blocks, with Lego bricks, and with actual real bricks. So when our house was finished, we had about 400 or 500 bricks left over. And rather than send the bricks back, my mother said, "I'm going to build a patio with it sometime." So the brick piles stayed at the house. Sometime turned into years. And as the years went by, those brick piles got smaller and smaller. And it wasn't because of anything she was doing. It was because kids will find things to do with a big pile of bricks. We built all kinds of things. We built bicycle ramps. out of leftover plywood and bricks, and there was not a ramp, no matter how narrow, no matter how high it was, that Keith Phillips would not jump. Or that my brother Chris wouldn't crash into. And we had lots of time on our hands back then. This was before iPhones. This was before video games. This was the 70s. There was nothing to do but go outside and play. And during the summer, we could be out all day long. And we would come up with ideas of things to do with all these bricks. We had a funeral for a dead cat we found, and we built an altar. And that day, Bob O'Neill was over at my house, and Bob could preach the best eulogy for a dead animal than anybody I knew. We had lots of fun like that. But the most inspiring and daring project we ever did was the construction of the Great Woodland Way Dam. It was one of those summer days we were all out of school. It was pouring rain all day long. And back then, kids would just go out and play in the rain. It didn't matter, as long as it wasn't lightning or thundering. We would be outside playing in the rain, and somebody, I won't say who it was, had the brilliant idea of let's dam up the drainage system on Woodland Way. But to do that, we needed bricks, so the kids headed to the brick pile. Here comes bricks. And right where we were was a confluence of varying drainage systems from Watkins Street that fed into this drain right in front of our house and then went down the long hill to Marcy Carmichael's house where it poured out in the creek. So we started stacking our bricks. So the first thing we had to do was to put in a good foundation. We started brick by brick. I was the engineer on this project. And we quickly realized the water was just going to go right through the bricks, so we needed cement. We didn't have cement, but we decided to make mud. So we were digging dirt into a bucket, filling it with water and making mud, and packing it in there. And of course, the water's washing the mud down. So then we decided we needed a double wall dam. This was a brilliant invention. We had two walls of bricks, and we filled it with mud. And it worked, and the water began to back up, and we stacked higher, and then we realized we needed a lot more bricks. So I said, go get more bricks. They took off. They came back with a wheelbarrow full of bricks. Keith had one handle. My brother and his brother had the other handle. It was like two people trying to drive a car with two different front ends on it, and they crashed, and all the bricks came out, and we kept building. The water kept getting higher and higher. At one point, we finally had to get Joe Waits out of the ditch because he was the youngest and the smallest of us, and it was up to his neck, and we were afraid he was going to drown. In rivers, we wanted to drown a few times. But we built this dam, and the water began to back up everywhere, and the water from across the street in the shallow ditch across the street couldn't get through the pipe that ran under the street. And it began to back up over there, and then it began to overtop the road. And we were like, this is cool, we're flooding the road. And that was about the time the Jackson Police Department showed up. I don't know who called them. I have my suspicions, but probably it was for the best, and he made us tear down our wonderful dam. But it just goes to show that there are lessons that even kids can learn standing in a ditch in a pouring down rainstorm. One of them is about setting a good foundation. Foundations are the most important part of a building. You can't do anything else without first putting down the foundation. You listen to the words that I read just a few minutes ago where he said, upon this rock I shall build my church. Jesus symbolically laid the first stone on the foundation of the church, charging Peter to be the cornerstone of that church. Caesarea Philippi was the place that Jesus chose to make a stand and asked his disciples to do that with him. And Jesus wasn't saying he would build his church on Peter, but he was building his church on what Peter had said. when he said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." This was the foundation of the church, what Peter had said and what Peter knew to be true. In talking about our sermon topic today, I want to say I love how the Bible uses illustrations. And if you look for the word foundation, you can find it in all kinds of scriptures throughout the Bible. From 2 Chronicles, we hear the foundation Solomon laid for the building of the temple of God was 60 cubits long and 20 cubits wide. From 1 Kings, the foundation of the Lord's temple was laid in midspring in the month of Ziv during the fourth year of Solomon's reign. From 1 Timothy, in this way, they will lay up treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. The prophet Isaiah wrote, "He will be the sure foundation for your times, a rich store of salvation and wisdom and knowledge." And even in our hymns, when we sing, "The church's one foundation is Jesus Christ our Lord." All of this is part of what makes up the foundation of our church, built brick by brick. Building a house, building a country, building a church is done pretty much the same way, because the first thing you have to do is either pour a foundation or build up a foundation. If you look at all these home improvement shows that they have where these people go out and find a house that they want to fix up for somebody, the first thing they do is check the foundation, because if the foundation has problems, it doesn't matter what they're going to do with the rest of the house. They have to get that fixed first. Churches can and have failed because of bad foundations. Either they weren't right to begin with, or they were neglected and allowed to crumble. Our own church, our United Methodist Church, has been shaken a few times in its history. But our strong foundation, which was laid by Jesus in the origins of the church, built upon by Peter, nurtured by John Wesley, and fostered by generations of Christians, has persevered and will continue to push forward, secure that its foundations are strong and it can bear the weight of everything on it. I say this to illustrate how important they are, because it's not just about buildings, it's about the foundations we lay for ourselves. We start with our children. We always want to build a good foundation for our children in church, in the education they receive, and in their life in general, because we know that setting a good foundation for them will help to ensure their success later in life. I always felt like growing up in this community that a lot of you contributed to the bricks of my own foundation, which is still being built. It's never over while you live. Your foundation is always being built. But people like the people I went to church with, my parents, my grandparents, teachers, neighbors, the pastors over the years, all of them contributed bricks to the foundation that I am on. And things that we learned when we were kids that started that foundation, we don't always know who taught us these things, but we know them. We learned them somewhere. We learned that Jesus loves me, this I know, because somebody told us that. We may not remember who it was. It could have been a grandmother or a Sunday school teacher. We don't always know who it was, but we know somebody taught us that. We know that in seeking Christ, that we are building our own foundations, but we can't do it alone. We have to have help from others. Our Christian life and our ministry to others begins at the laying of the foundation of Christ Jesus. So all ministry that's faithful and that is fruitful finds its roots in the life, death, and resurrection of Christ. Where there's a church or a mission or a ministry that's built on something other than that, there's a good chance it's going to fail. We should count on others, especially those whose lives we can influence and whose foundations we can contribute to. And think of each other as fellow laborers working towards the same goal, laying those bricks, building up a foundation that our churches and the Church Universal can rest upon. There's another passage from the Scriptures, from the book of Ephesians. It says, "So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple of the Lord. In him, you are also being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit." We're being built to be vessels for the Holy Spirit, for God. So right there in that passage, we see the blueprint for the entire church, for all churches, and for our role in it. The foundation is the apostles and the prophets. Christ is the cornerstone, and we, each of us, are being built into a dwelling place for God. I think one of the reasons that people sometimes fall away from the church is because they can put their faith in the wrong foundation. We tend to put our faith in an individual church, not the church itself, but an individual church sometimes, or in a pastor, or in certain people in the church. But the thing about it is those are not eternal things. Those are the things that will fail at some point. Most people will disappoint you at some point in their life. Hopefully just once, but they will, because they have human frailties and human failings. Writing to the church at Corinth, Paul pointed out that for no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. He wanted us to make sure that we clearly understood that nothing else that was laid down could be compared to the foundation of Christ. It was unfailing, it was unending, and it was unassailable. Think for a moment about the people who laid the very first bricks of our own church. Not the building, but the church that has endured for over 200 years. Do you think when Mary Buttrell built a log cabin at the entrance of the cemetery on the other side of town in 1818, that she thought she was building a church that would endure for hundreds of years? She just wanted to make sure her family were instructed in the Christian life and that there was food on the table. Those were her worries, I'm sure. But she built something that endured. Again, not a building, but a church. And our church being a part of the whole church. Imagine that the people who start any church or mission or movement, back when they started it, a lot of them probably didn't realize what they were starting or that they were starting anything at all. They were doing what was necessary at the time. They saw a need, and they created churches. They went on mission work, and they did all of the things that needed to be done, and they never lived to see the results of what they accomplished in many cases. I always think about the story of the Washington National Cathedral, the beautiful church that sits up on a high hill in Washington, D.C., how they started that church and finished it nearly 100 years later, and the third generation of workers was working on it. The first generation, most of them had not lived to see the completion of that project, but they knew what it was going to be someday, and multiple generations. It's the same with these stained glass windows. They were installed by one person, they were worked on in the 70s by his son, and then they were restored again a few years ago by his grandson. People do things that they don't realize what the end game or the end result is going to be. They don't realize the impact they will have years down the road in the future. I love those kind of stories. We've been shaken a lot in the last few years, though. our country has, our personal lives have. The last 5 years have been rough on people in a lot of ways. But I think we can take comfort in knowing that our foundations as Christians and as a church are pretty strong. And if we find that they aren't, then it's time to make repairs and to fix things. To make sure that we seal the cracks and hopefully with something better than mud and water. To keep the dampness and the wet out and the dry in, to preserve. As we prepare to depart this morning, I want to challenge each of you to remember that our churches and the church families are built of stronger stuff than we think we are. And our foundations, rooted deeply in our Christian convictions, are strong enough to get us through the occasional storms and downpours of rain in our life. I hope if you think any this week on this message or what I've said, that you won't lose sight of the fact that each one of you in some way have helped lay the foundation for someone's life in Christ. And in doing so, you've all been ministers of the faith. Always remember that the foundation we build our lives on affects our ability to endure life's challenges. When we build our lives on the physical ideologies of the world, our lives will often fail during the bad times. We build on the unswerving faith of God. If Jesus is the bedrock foundation for our lives, we can keep our spiritual, mental, and emotional balance during the times that we find ourselves in. One of the greatest things we can do is to teach others to build on that same great foundation. Whether you're building a church or a house or a building or just a brick dam made of bricks and mud, always be sure to put it on a strong foundation. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Now let us stand and sing our hymn of invitation, the Battle Hymn of the Republic, page 717. Amen.
Thank you. the mercy and peace of God the Father who walks before us, God the Son who stands behind us, and God the Holy Spirit who surrounds us, uplifts us, and strengthens us. Bless you, preserve you, and keep you all now and evermore. Amen.